I will quench your thirst with the Lord. I will quench the barren place in your heart. I will quench your thirst. I will fill you. I will fill you to overflowing. My cup is full. My arm is not short that I cannot save. My river still flows. My life is abundant. I will pour out upon you. I will fill you, says the Lord. I will fill you to overflowing. And out of the overflow, you can go forth. Out of the overflow. But allow me to fill you, says the Lord. Allow me to flood through you. Allow me to flow over the banks of your life. Allow me to flood over the outskirts. Allow me to enlarge the borders of your tent. Allow me to stretch you and to build you. Allow me to flow beyond what you can see. For I will pour out above and beyond what you can ask or think. Allow me to fill you, says the Lord. Allow me to bless you. Allow me to spoil you. Allow me into every recess of your life. Allow me to be your Lord and to be in control. Allow me to take the steering wheel of your life. Allow me to guide and to direct. Allow me to flow, and I will fill you with overflowing, says the Lord. I will fill you. I will fill you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. We drink of you.
I exalt thee, I exalt thee, I exalt thee, O Lord, I exalt thee. I exalt thee, I exalt thee, O Lord.
Good morning, everybody. To partake of communion is to accept Jesus' invitation to become one with him. It's the kind of beautiful intimacy that transforms you and sparks a hunger to become more Christ-like. In Matthew 26, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." This little biscuit isn't just a symbol, it's an opportunity to take the bread of life and consume it. We're saying yes to a deep hunger for the Word of God, to resemble the only man who knew no sin. It's his body that we eat. And the saying goes, you are what you eat. And in this case, I want nothing more to become more like Christ. Jesus takes the cup and gives thanks, and he gives it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of many sins." This cup in our hands is Jesus' perfect sacrifice. There is no stain of sin that this blood cannot remove. There is nothing in comparison that can cleanse us like the blood of Jesus. Drinking this cup is an act of surrender to the need for Jesus to purify us, to take our guilt and shame from sin and make us new again. No matter what dirt we picked up over the week from gossip, anger, lies, or whatever other sin, it's his blood that we drink, and in this cup cleanses us from it all. His mercies are new every single morning, and it's this unmatched kindness that leads us to repentance. So on that note, I'll pray. Jesus, thank you for all that you did for us on the cross, Lord. Thank you that it's a gift that we get to have this beautiful relationship with you, Lord. God, I pray that as we eat the bread that represents your body, Lord, that we would just be filled with who you are, Jesus. Lord, I want to look like you. I want to talk like you and walk like you, Jesus. God, I just pray that as I consume your body, I just become more like you, Lord. And all my friends too, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that as we drink the cup that represents your blood, that it would just wash us from the inside out, Lord, that it would shine through our faces, God. Thank you that we would feel just how clean we are because we've been washed in you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you for sending your Son, Lord. We are so grateful for all that you've done for us, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hi, Georgia. We went to some meetings the last couple of nights, didn't we? Tell me a little about what happened to you.
I got prayer for some healing, and the power of God just came over me, and I was just couldn't stop laughing. I was like, it like literally felt like God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit were having a party, and I was the house. And on the second night, I fell on the floor, and I was laughing again. And yeah, I believe I've been completely healed as well, and I've just had the joy of the Lord ever since. Like, it just hasn't gone away. It's like still there.
How did you say it? How did you say it? They were having a party and you were the house.
Yeah. It was like a raging party. Like, yeah.
That's awesome. Thank you, sweetie. That's awesome. Deb, come and tell us about your encounter. Yeah, last night.
Last night I was sort of on the page with Georgia over there. We went to Mark Heenan's meetings that we were advertising, as we told you about, and it was really funny because Mark, I don't even know why, but I just sort of got the giggles because that's what happens sometimes with me when I get in the presence of God. But then I was sort of sitting there, and then all of a sudden Mark came over and he says, "So Deborah, tell me what God's doing in you." And as soon as he came near me, it was like the joy was so strong. I just slid off the chair and onto the floor, and that was it. It was just gone. But it was sort of like there's so much liberty in that.
There is liberty, isn't there?
Yep.
In the presence of the Lord is liberty.
Yes, God.
I didn't understand a word of it. Okay. I'll just leave you there.
Yeah,
one more? In the presence of the Lord is liberty. Liberty, liberty. There is liberty. There is liberty. There's liberty in it. Isn't there liberty? Isn't there liberty? What's that Psalm 16 says? Where the presence of the Lord is, there's fullness of joy. Fullness of joy. It amazes me that when the fullness of joy comes, it's just so liberating. It just lifts all the stress and all the pressure. So tell me, Deb. I did want to go somewhere with all this. Come over. Yeah. You know, I'm making a point because this is what I want to speak about today. That the presence of the Lord is so important that we keep the presence of the Lord around about us. Now, you're telling me, do you mind if I share, that at the end of last year,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
You're feeling a bit stressed.
It's bad.
Yeah, oh. Working hard, long days, you know, plenty going on, all the transition, all the things that will happen. You're feeling a bit stressed.
Mm-hmm. A lot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now tell me how you feel now.
I feel totally relaxed and actually looking forward to starting work tomorrow. And I'm not concerned because I was really worried. I was on the edge of burnout last year. And it was sort of like all that fear and all that concern has just dissipated completely. And I'm just like brand new and fresh and feeling awesome. Yeah, so I feel great. I really feel really, really good.
So that's what liberty does.
Yeah.
That's what liberty. See, God knows our needs. He knows the areas of our heart we need the presence of God to encounter and meet with us. He knows the issues of our heart. This isn't just because, you know, I've good for Deb. No, it's because, you know, she needed to find peace. We all need the peace of God in our heart. He is the Prince of Peace. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Let me tell you our one announcement before we go too far. Is that we're still meeting, we're still having church. We're going to be having prayer meeting Tuesday night at 7 to 8. Then from 8 to 9, we're going to have a music practice. So we don't have to go out twice. And in February, we'll start up all our other stuff and just wait till we get over this hump of all the stuff that's going on. But we want you to encourage you to keep your focus on Jesus. He is our answer. He is our answer. There's Isaiah 9:6. There's that one. Isaiah 9:6, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, the government will be upon his shoulder, his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Unto us a son is born, and he is the Prince of Peace. He brings peace that passes understanding. He brings liberty. He brings joy. You know, anybody, I don't know, maybe none of you have experienced a little bit of a challenge in the last, I don't know, 2 years, but there's some things going on. Hello, if you haven't noticed. But we've got to understand that we have a God who does not change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the same. We're going through some interesting things in this world, but we've got to lay our foundation on Jesus. He is the Prince of Peace. Hello? And when we find that liberty, when we allow the presence of God to carry us, like just like Deb was saying, when the presence of God comes and lifts off all the stress and all the pressure, it allows us to navigate life with a different foundation. Take some more. You need some more. There's something so lovely about joy. Some people it offends. Some people are offended with joy. Some people are, I don't understand how people can not want the liberty that Jesus brings. Hello? And people like to be so in control, they don't want joy, they don't want liberty, they don't want the life that Jesus brings. He says, I've come to bring life and life more abundantly. That's our Jesus. He's the life giver. He's the abundant God. He's the one who comes to lift off all the pressures. Cast your cares upon him because he cares for you. Hello? Isn't that what the Bible says? That's what Jesus says. He had joy above his fellows. He's full of joy, full of liberty, full of life. There was nothing that stressed Jesus except our burden of sin. When he went to the garden and carried that in the garden and the pressure of carrying our sin, our stuff, that was the only thing that pressured Jesus. So much so that he sweat blood when he carried our stuff. That was the only burden. It's a bigger burden than you and I can carry. I remember I went through a time when it was just too much for me, all the stuff going on in my world. Said, God, this stuff is too much for me. I can't carry it. Can you please carry it? And he lifted it off me. He carries our burdens. He carries it. Don't carry it yourself. Let him carry it. Let him. Give it to him. What he's saying, let him carry all this stuff. I don't know about you, but I've got a bunch of kids. Some of you may have children, some may not. But I've found the bigger your family grows, the more concerns you have because you love them. Any grandparents here? You know what I'm talking about, don't you? You know, we get family, brothers, sisters, uncles, aunts, kids, grandchildren, relatives, and things go on in their world, and because we love them, we get concerned. Is that true? Come on. This has got to matter where we live. It's got to matter in the day-to-day. It's got to matter in our lives. And we have our children, our grandchildren, our mums, our dads, our family, our you know, and stuff goes on in their world, and we carry burdens for them. We carry burdens for them. But we have a God who carried every burden. We have a God who knows all of our stuff, knows everything. But the Bible says this about him. Hebrews 13:8. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He does not change. He doesn't change. He is immutable. It means he doesn't change. Big fancy word for saying he doesn't change. There are some things God cannot do. He cannot change. That's something he can't do. He cannot change. And there's another thing he cannot do. He cannot lie. Because he's a God of truth. He cannot change. He cannot lie. And when he says he carries our burdens, he means it. It's truth. He carries it for us. Cast your cares upon him. So when we're caring and having compassion for our family, our children, our sons, our daughters, uncles, aunts, mums and dads, we can cast our care upon him and allow him into their world and believe him to help them in their world. We're supposed to be family. On his shoulders is the government. The government of God is family. It's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's a family. The government of God is supposed to be family. And of the increase of his government, there will be no end. His government is not bureaucracy. Sometimes when we think of government, we think of, oh, you know, the politician. We think of, you know, they're trying to control us. They're trying to do this. They're trying to do that. They're trying to do something else. There's bureaucracy. There's things. You know, when we're trying to navigate government. But when we think of God's government, of the increase of his government, there will be no end. We think, well, gee, if it's anything like our government, that's scary. But God's government is family. And of the increase of his family, there will be no end. So when you understand God's perspective and God's context, changes the whole deal. And so we can come to God when the increase of his family and believe for his family to increase by touching our family. And believe for our mums and dads to be touched by God. Believe for our sons and daughters to be carried by God. Believe for their souls, for their salvation, for them to come into the kingdom and for the kingdom of God to carry them, just as it's carried you and me. And when we get our eyes off our own circumstances, it makes a whole different world where it's about others. The whole world is made of others. There are 6 billion others on this world, apart from you. That's a lot of others. That's a lot of people out there. So when you carry burdens of others, it can be too big for you. Put it upon God. Allow him to carry it. He won't change. He can't change. He's a God who made this place, who set it up. But we've got to look from that eternal perspective. Hebrews 6:19, let's have a look at that one. This hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which enters the presence behind the veil. Hope enters into the presence of God. We've got to enter into his presence and allow him to carry it. Get into that place of liberty. Get into that joy. Allow God to lift it off your heart. Allow the stresses to lift off your life. Allow him to carry you. We surely will carry us on his shoulders. Our God is a rock that cannot change. He's a good God. I'm just trying to help us to stay focused on how to navigate and to walk through this season of life, through this stuff that's going on. There's plenty of stuff going on. There's plenty. There's plenty of cares, plenty of challenges, plenty of issues. But we have a God who is the Prince of Peace. Hello. Did you hear the prophetic word that came through this morning? Stand firm. Stand firm. Let me tell you one of the biblical stories about this. It's King David in 1 Samuel chapter 30. I'll read a bit of this for you. Now, David had been anointed to be king, but Saul didn't like him much because Saul was already king. And it happened when David, his men came to Ziklag, which was a town of the Philistines that he was living in with all his 400 men and their wives and their families. They came to Ziklag on the third day. The Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag. They attacked Ziklag, their town, burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were there from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but had carried them away and went their way. So David and his men came home to the city, and there it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters had been taken captive. I mean, that's a tough story. That's a tough gig. He'd come home and everything had been taken. I've been through a season where everything was taken. And I found God did not change. He was still with me. And God is with him. He's with us. David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives, Ahinoam and Abigail, had been taken captive. And David was greatly distressed. Have you ever been greatly distressed? Hello? Come on. The trials of the righteous are many, but the Lord delivers us from them all. We get distressed. Stuff happens. Life happens. Things happen to us. It's not about denying the stuff that happened. Things go on. David was greatly distressed because the people spoke of stoning him. They were going to kill him, his own people. That's not a lot of support. That's not a lot of encouragement for those around him. And the people of the soul were grieved for every man for his sons and daughters. And here's one of the most key verses in the Old Testament. David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. He strengthened himself in the Lord his God. This is really what I want to encourage you today. To strengthen yourself in God. Strengthen yourself. One of the things that we do in coming to church is to strengthen each other, to encourage one another in the presence of God, to strengthen. But we've got to know how to strengthen ourselves in God. Encourage yourself in God. How to stand firm. We had that word this morning. Come drink of the Spirit. Stand firm. We've got to stand firm. Stand strong. Strengthen yourself. When everything looks like it's going to already gone, been taken, and you've got to know how to strengthen yourself. I was listening, and when I go to these meetings, I've seen so many miracles in my time. Going to these meetings and just watching how Mark operates, watching him, how he moves in the Spirit, listening to the Holy Ghost, what's happening here, what's going on there. And I want to learn how to be more of a man of the Spirit and how to hear the voice of the Spirit, how to know what God is doing, how's it working, how's it flowing. What I used to do here with Neil. Watch Neil. How does he work? What's going on? Spirit of God, what are you doing? What's happening here? And we should learn to be people of the Spirit. So I was watching Mark, watching him. And, he would how to release the presence and the power of God. But mostly Mark's gift was discernment. And he would just discern the root cause of why people were unwell. And a lot of the time, as you were there, Meg, you were just saying to me earlier, a lot of the time, it had spiritual causes. It wasn't natural. It was spiritual. That's why people have battle with trying to get well. It's because the spiritual thing couldn't be dealt with through medication or doctors. You've got to deal spirit with spirit. And as I'd watch Mark operate, as I watch, you know, the discernment of finding out what are the issues that are dealing with, that are affecting people, and he would discern. And when the discernment came, then the power of God could flow to that and people would be set free. Broke the power, break the spiritual source of that thing. You and I are spirit people. And it's the same for us, that we've got to discern the cause of what's, you know, where is this pressure coming from? What is the issue? How do we deal with it? So much of the issues of our life come out of the heart, and we've got to deal with them spiritually. Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and peace that passes understanding comes from the Spirit, not from trying to figure it out, not from trying to control circumstances, not from trying to change everything around me so it's all nice and lovely, but it comes out of the Spirit of life within us. Hello? It's got to come from the Spirit. From the Spirit flows life. From the Spirit, the flesh profits nothing. It's the Spirit that brings life. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. He wants to give peace to our world. David strengthened himself in God. He encouraged himself. He took a hold of who God was, reminded himself of who God is in his life, in his world, and strengthened himself in God. We've got to know how to strengthen ourselves. We've got to know how to stand firm and pick up the sword. We've got to be able to do that, otherwise you get pushed about. Hello? You're hearing this morning. Come on, this is the word of God for us. When stuff goes on, when pressures happen, when illness hits, when the plague comes, we've got to strengthen ourselves in God and in who God is in my world, in my family's world, in my sons and daughters. Believe God to break forth and break through into their world. Strengthen ourselves in God. Be strong. Stand firm. Focus on our unchanging God. Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. We got that one? This is what happened. I'll just finish this story. David strengthened himself and he said, "Let me hear from God." Spoke to the high priest, "Bring the ephod here to me." So they brought it and he inquired of the Lord, "Shall I pursue this troop?" And God said, "Pursue, for you shall surely overtake them and without fail recover all." So they did. And he went and recovered everything. They got all their wives and families back. But if David hadn't strengthened himself, if he hadn't have been a leader and stood up and led, if he hadn't have inquired in God and strengthened himself, he'd probably be dead. They would have killed him. We've got to strengthen ourselves. We've got to allow the life flow of the liberty of God to get around about us and make us laugh again in the midst of stress. Sometimes it's the most offensive thing to laugh when everything's going south. I don't know if you've heard that sort of testimony. You know, when people are experiencing just deep distress and stuff is going on in their world and grief and God comes upon them and they just begin to laugh. It's so offensive to our natural mind. Really, we can get offended with it because the natural mind says this is not right. And religious people get upset with joy. What's that, Darren? And that when the liberty comes, it's so refreshing. Don't be a party pooper in God's party. We've got to allow the life to flow through it. Enjoy it. Let the liberty come. When you're under pressure, the best thing you can have is sometimes just a good laugh. Just to enjoy God. Let it lift. Let it flow off. Get rid of it. Get rid of it, I say. Let God come. Lift your heart. Encourage Him. Let His peace flow. Let the joy flow. We heard this testimony yesterday from some friends of ours. And she was telling me that, was it her or a friend of hers? Anyway, she was going shopping and everybody looked miserable. I don't know why they would have looked miserable at this time with stuff going on. Everybody looked miserable. She was going to the shop and she saw this mother and a daughter full of joy. And she just said, she didn't ask them, she didn't talk to them, but she thought, God is all over them. They're full of joy. And she said a couple of times she just had to go and stand near them just to soak up the presence of God that was on them because of the joy that was on. Everybody else, full of misery, but just let the joy come. Hello? I thought, now that's wisdom. Let the liberty get around about you. Let it lift you. It doesn't mean that you don't, that you deny the facts. Faith does not deny the facts, does not deny the circumstances, does not ignore them. But faith says this is there's a better future. There is hope in God. There is a future. There is hope. There is life. There is peace. There is liberty. And we walk in liberty through the trials and circumstances and allow God to carry us. He's the Prince of Peace. We must come to the rock that is higher than I. That verse in Deuteronomy, verse 4. He is the rock. He's unchanging. He is perfect. For all His ways are justice, a God of truth and without injustice. Righteous and upright is He. That's our God. So when we look at Him, He is a rock that doesn't change. He is the rock. He is immovable. His ways are perfect. Hello? Come on. Strengthen yourselves in God. Allow God to lift your focus. Allow the presence of God to come around about you. Allow the joy of it to carry you. Allow the liberty of who He is to carry you. To be His spoilt child. To be His one that He pours His love on and accept it from God. Let joy come to you. Let peace flow to you. Holy Ghost. Here's a few more verses. 1 Samuel 2, verse 2. No one is holy like the Lord, for there is none beside you, nor is there any rock like our God. 111 times the Bible says God is a rock. He's unchanging. He's absolute. He is a rock. We can stand on that rock. 2 Samuel 22, verse 2. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer. Psalm 61, verse 2. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock. When we've got to come to the rock, we've got to come to Jesus. We've got to come to that firm foundation that is higher than I, that bigger than me, greater than my circumstances. When stuff flows over me, I've got to come back to that foundation. Jesus is my foundation. Hello. He is my foundation. He is my rock. He's the unchanging one. When circumstances want to get more than I can bear, when my workplace is annoying me, I've got to come back to the foundation, my rock. When the circumstances in my home are pressuring me, come back to the rock. When stuff going on in my family, come back to the rock. When everybody in the supermarket is miserable, come back to the rock. Be the one that people want to be near because you've got carrying something special. Because you're carrying the presence of God. Because you're carrying peace. Come into His presence. Allow His presence to lift you. Allow Him. Oh, God. Oh, God. Holy Ghost. Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 27 says the wise man will build his house on the rock, but the wise man is whoever hears the word of God and does them. You've got to do the word of God. It's not enough just to hear it. You've got to hear it and do it. You've got to do the word of God. You've got to do what Jesus said. You've got to do these things. Whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. The foolish man, the stupid man, the twit, he heard them, but he didn't do them. Both heard them. We've got to build our house on the rock. If you look at the whole of Matthew chapter 7 in the beginning of that and what he actually says to do, it says this: do not judge. Judge not unless you be judged in the same manner. It's so easy to be critical. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's easy to criticize. It's easy to get paranoid. It's easy to say, okay, you know, I hear so many people with attitude these days, you know, about things that are going on because it's impacting. And when you get pressured, what's inside of you will come out. And it's so easy to get critical, judgmental. Government's doing this. They're trying to control us. We're doing something else. Somebody else's fault. They shouldn't do this. Why are they doing that? And we start getting critical. But here's the thing. Criticism and a judgmental attitude will not build the kingdom of God within you and not will allow you to walk in peace. It robs our peace. It robs the kingdom of God within us. Criticism. Criticism, and that's what happens when pressure comes. Oftentimes we criticize our leaders. When we have pressure in the world, we criticize the politician. We have pressure in the church, we criticize the pastor. This, you know, it's a natural response to criticize when things are not going well. Not going well in my workplace, it's the boss's fault. Hello? And we criticize. And so we've got to learn to keep diligent and not allow a judgmental spirit to get within us. It's not just, you know, denying the things that are going south, but we've got to stay sweet. One of the things I love about Deb, that she stays so sweet. Her boss says about Deb that she warms up every room she walks into. She's such a sweet person. Deb works at Legal Aid, and every single client that comes to that counter is in trauma. Every single one. In difficult circumstances. Fathers that can't see their children. People, you know, who are up for all sorts of crime. Every one of them's in trauma. And Deb just has the approach, I'm going to bring hope to them. Point them in the direction of their help, but speak life. And she's just so good at it. I don't know why she'd want to burn out. Put me in there for a day, that'd cook me. She does it all the time. See, it's what's in you that flows out of you. We've got to have the Prince of Peace in us to come back to God who is higher than I, my rock. My sure foundation. I'm not allowing a critical, judgmental heart to flow out of me. Then he goes on to say, don't practice lawlessness. You know, and there will be those who say, I did this and I did that and I cast out devils and I did things. And Jesus will say, you know, there's no room in the kingdom for you who practice lawlessness. I don't know you. We've got to obey and do what we're supposed to do. And you know, whether we like it or not, whether the situation we're in, don't be lawless. Don't try and kick outside of the boundaries that are placed upon us. We'll just obey and do our best and be diligent to walk with God. The only time that Jesus ever got angry, I think I mentioned this last week, The only time he ever got angry with the situation that was in the arena of the day was when they interfered with people worshipping God. When they went into the temple and there were money changers, he sat down and made a whip. Jesus didn't suddenly get angry. He spent the time to make a whip. And he drove out the money changers because they were messing up the temple of God. That annoys God. When you get in front of relationship with him, he's a jealous God. He doesn't like that much. Okay. Don't judge. Then it talks about being a good steward of holiness, that we steward a right walk with God. This is in all in Matthew chapter 7. That we steward our holiness, our right walk. The Bible says, you know, our passion should be pursuing the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That we pursue and steward that holiness with God. That we pursue the good things of God. That we discern what is right. Strong meat belongs to those who, by reason of use, have exercised their senses to discern between good and evil. That we discern what is right. That's all in Matthew chapter 7. That's all the things that it says to build our lives on the rock. Just two more verses I have for you. One is Philippians 4 verse 6. It says this, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." Jesus is the Prince of Peace. And if we're going to walk in peace, there are some things that we're allowed to be anxious about. There's a big long list of them right there. Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious, you listening on the website, be anxious for nothing. Do not be anxious for your health. Do not be anxious for your finances. Do not be anxious for the situation and circumstances of the day. Do not be anxious is the command of the Word of God. Let fear be broken off you in Jesus' name. Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Do not be anxious for the pressures of work. Do not be anxious for the plague. Do not be anxious for what the government is saying and doing. Do not be anxious about your circumstances. Do not be anxious. Do not be anxious. We should fear nothing as Christians. Nothing. But let your requests be made known to God. And God, who knows all, will keep your hearts and minds in peace and allow the peace of heaven to flow into your inner life. And walk in peace. He's the Prince of Peace. Allow peace to come over you. Allow peace to flow to you. Allow peace in your thoughts. Allow peace into your home. Let peace into your family. He is peace. He is the God of peace. John 16, 33. "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have some tribulation, some trial." In the world, there is some stuff going on. In the world, you will have. In the world, there is. Jesus didn't deny it. "But be of good cheer." What sort of cheer? Be of good cheer. This is what we're supposed to be like. Be of good cheer. Be full of joy. Be full of joy. You got any? Got some too. Be of good cheer. Hello. Be of good cheer. Be full of joy. Be full of joy. Jesus has overcome the world. Be full of joy. She's on. What an obedient girl.
Where's the roof?
Wonderful, Jesus. Be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Let the peace of Jesus keep your hearts and minds. Be of good cheer. Be ones that people want to come and stand next to in the supermarket. Be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Let peace come around about you. Let the peace that passes understanding. Sure, there's circumstances. Sure, there's a plague. Sure, there's things. Be of good cheer. Let peace carry you. Let his presence carry you. I don't know. I love that. I can drink of the sweetness of that. Let joy flow over. Holy Ghost. Is there anybody that would like just, you're wrestling with anxiety and you need peace? Love to pray with you. Love the presence of God to flow over you and peace to lift it out of your inner life. Come on. We've got to strengthen ourselves, but I'm happy to pray with you and agree with you. This is what God is saying to us. He came through that prophetic word and just confirming it to us. Be strong. Stand firm. Come on out. Allow me to pray with you. I'm sure there's more. Why don't we all stand to our feet? Stand to our feet. Stand to our feet. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence, your presence, your presence, your presence, your presence. Your presence, Holy Ghost. Your presence, Holy Ghost. Your presence, your presence, your presence. Your presence, your presence, your presence. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Come on. There are people here and you're battling with stuff. Let peace rule in your inner life. Oh, yeah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you for your anointing. Right. Father, thank you, Holy Ghost. Your peace, lifting off anxiety. Lift it off, Holy Ghost. There it goes. There it goes. Just lifting off now. Just lifting off. Lifting off. Just. Thank you, Holy Ghost. The heaviness is just lifting off. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Shade of a rubber roy shister. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Sweetness of God. Now the sweetness of God. You can sense that. It's almost like a burning down in your heart. Just following down that there's like a line. How can I describe this, Holy Ghost? It's like there's a touch of grief. But God just wants to burn in your life. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. That's just so beautiful. Beautiful.